Hello, everyone, and welcome to Balance of Power, the new roleplay show. I'm JP McDaniel, joined by the rest of the cast. Do we need to do introductions? I don't know. We've kind of done this already back in December.
I mean, December was a long time ago in internet
I guess
time.
December. Yeah, you know, people forget. It's been four months. Let's just go around the horn here. Strippin, we'll start with you. Quick introduction, who you are, what you do.
Hi, my name's Strippin. I play video games for a living on YouTube/Strippin and Twitch/Strippin.
Jordan, and who did you play last? Let's talk about, you know, the last time Strippin played Age of Rebellion. How about we do that?
The last time I played Age of Rebellion, I was like, I'm going to play a Jedi, and I failed every single dice roll, and then I was killed at the end by...
To be fair, you were, like, the worst Jedi. You're like, I'm going to play a Jedi. I'm so passionate right now.
No, here's what happened, is Adam was like, oh, you want to play a Jedi? They're overpowered, so I'm just going to whoop your ass, and then killed me. So I learned my lesson, and today I will not be playing a Jedi.
You did roll really poorly. It's true. Yeah. Like, I mean, the force was not with you.
Let's just say every time I rolled, you used one of those extra dice to make sure I failed.
Basically, you were like, I'm going to use the force. And the force was like, no. I got something to do right now.
The force
is
just checked out. Yeah. I'm busy today.
Do you hear my phone ringing? I got to be ready.
Anyway, I've learned my lesson. I will never be playing a Jedi again.
All right. There you go. Also, I guess we should state that as far as I know, unless Adam has some crazy tricks in his sleeve, that's not related at all to that show. Those two shows that we did in December is not related at all to this story. Correct?
Yeah, they take place quite a ways apart in time too. That story was between Empire and Jedi, and this one will take place after Jedi. So it's been a while since then. And those characters, like, we may refer back to it, like that actually happened, but it's not going to be the focus of the game.
Okay, awesome stuff. The last time you saw Jesse Cox, he was covered in gold paint and droiding it up.
Yeah, I'm not a droid anymore. I'm just a normal human being. So that's a thing. Wow, it's great to be back, and I'm a little jealous that some of us, no names, are dressed a little bit better than the rest of us.
It's true. We won't mention who this particular female is on the show.
Who the tryhard is on the show. But
it's not my fault that my cosplay did not arrive yet. Only one piece of it did, which is a shame. So eventually, I'll look just as fabulous in my long wig. I can't wait to do this. Let's have the fun. Okay. Also, yeah, Jesse Cox on everything. Look it up. Google it.
There you go. Last time we saw Pocket, she was covered in blue, right?
Yeah. Well, I mean, technically you saw me yesterday, but I was a Twi'lek last time,
right.
And I regretted that instantly. It was so painful on my head. I had like headaches for like a week, but I was a Twi'lek last time. I survived and was, you know, I might have shot some people then, so I hope to, you know, shoot things today, maybe a little bit, just maybe. I think I'm like the most. I don't know. It's gonna be so fun, and I'm really. I'm not try hard, please.
Sam's just jealous. He's just jealous that you beat us all out.
Yeah, Sam's super jealous.
Yeah, super salty.
Yo, just go get your robe again, Sam.
Wait.
Go get your bathrobe.
No.
Why did you look up?
To pretend you're
you
Jedi
store your
again.
Jedi robe up top?
We don't
what the
need
fuck
any more Darth Lebowski's from Sam.
I don't want to do that anymore. I don't want to live that life anymore.
I like to think that Sam just turned around and looked up, but has no idea what he was looking at or what he was looking for just then.
No, I was looking at Dodger's collection of wigs.
Oh,
the top of
our shelves there. Okay. I gotcha. I guess we should also I almost died of heat stroke last time we played this, so I'm not.
Does it feel good to have your own face?
It feels awesome to not be wearing this mask that I'm furiously sweating in. It's great.
For the record, I was trying to talk you into someone with a mask.
You were. No. You were. Yeah. That's true. But nope, fuck, I'm not about the Wookiee life this time. I feel like actually talking contributing to the story rather than just moaning every once in a while with a bad Wookiee yell. So
I really liked it. I think this is going to be a fun mystery to uncover, but I really liked how when you tweeted your character art, everyone was like, oh, Crusher part two. He's not going to say anything. Mute JP.
Oh, yeah, because I have the neck. Yeah, everyone saw the neck thing. Well, also, huge shout out, Sam. We should shout out the artist for that because it's your artist. So who made it?
Yeah, you can. It's her name's Tina Van Gerken. You can find her on Twitter at Van Gerken.
Van Gerken. She makes the good arts there at Van Gerken.
Hey, can I ask a question? I saw that art. How come all of you have scars everywhere? And I'm like a pristine glow. Like, what does that say about us? You guys are badasses. And I'm like, hey, y'all.
And
hey,
you're like, I don't get my hands dirty. I'm going to go drink some tea now.
I just figured I'd help y'all. What's going on? Like, my guy apparently does nothing. You guys are all scarred
someone
up.
Someone looking around in the back like, wait, where am I?
Everyone else had scars. I didn't even, to be honest,
yes,
I didn't look up close.
Scars on everybody.
Yeah. Didn't I say that I had a scar, though? I'm pretty sure I said I had a scar.
I forget. I honestly forget.
It's like... fine. Jesse, your character is just the guy who joined the rebellion after the Death Star blew up. You're like, yeah, okay, cool. Rebellion. Great. Hey, love the Alliance. I'm in.
Yeah, no, I've been a huge fan.
You were first in line after it blew up, yeah. You immediately ran as it was blowing up.
Thank goodness that Death Star's toast. Woo! There you go. Like that thing.
There you go. Did you link that in the chat, Strippin? Because if not, I will.
I did, yeah.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I just want to give some shout-outs because she was quite awesome in all that as well. Then last but not least, Adam, who's going to be running. We usually have, like, you know, the Space Master, the Game Master, the Dungeon Master. This time he's Emperor. Because we're playing Star Wars, so it's Emperor Koebel.
Somebody's got to take over after Palpatine got thrown down a mine shaft or whatever.
Yeah,
so
it's true.
I'm going to stay away from high platforms. I'm going to stay close to the ground this session.
Good idea.
Yeah, I'm really excited. I love the Star Wars, so it's going to be nice to get back to that universe. And you know, my Sith robes are in the wash, but the real Dark Lord's power comes from within. So I'm gonna not cosplay this.
That is so true. What a valuable message to us all.
I read it on a Hallmark card once. The real darkness
dark
is inside.
You.
Yeah.
Hallmark card.
We were originally going to call me Supreme Leader Koebel, but it wouldn't fit on the overlay. So we'll just, Emperor's fine. It's fine.
We call you like Soup Leader.
Yeah, soup leader, sure.
There you go.
Soup Leader. I don't know. That's kind of like,
No, yeah. Soup Leader. We'll just call you Emperor. I will say, if you're watching on YouTube and you want to know more about the system before watching the actual game, there's a 30-minute video that me and Adam did that kind of walks you through the rolling and how all that works. Because it is a little bit more complicated than, you know, just straight up D&D. But if you're watching on Twitch, obviously, don't go watch that. You can just learn here as well, which I'm sure the cast is probably going to be doing as well. Because let's be honest, who watched a 30-minute video? So
I did right before the show.
Not me.
We don't know if Pocket's gonna plead the fifth. We don't know if Pocket did.
What's the opposite of a tryhard? Because that's what all y'all are. Yeah.
But yeah, I guess without further ado, let's go ahead and get started. It's the fastest intro in roleplay history, under 10 minutes.
Yeah. Yeah. Don't worry. By the time we get to episode like 25, it'll be most of the show, just like Swan Song. It's cool.
Yeah.
But for now, we just
want a Star Wars.
Want a Star Wars.
It's true. So, yeah, we will begin in the traditional fashion, in the way of our people, with the darkness of space and those beautiful words in blue. A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away, fades out. Cue trumpets, and the opening crawl begins. I know you can hear it. You can hear it in your mind right now. And as the crawl makes its way up the screen, we see RollPlay, Balance of Power. The Empire has been defeated. Its horrific battle station, the Death Star, has been destroyed by a brave band of rebels, and the Galactic Emperor is dead. The fight is far from over, however, and Imperial holdouts continue to struggle against the forces of the New Republic throughout the galaxy. The war is over, but the conflict between light and darkness is far from finished. On the Outer Rim, a team of rebels fights to liberate those still trapped under harsh Imperial rule. And so as the crawl finishes making its way up the screen, we get a nice slow pan down to a harsh volcanic world. We can see a bleak landscape of obsidian and basalt There's a, you know, a volcano erupts into the sky as the camera pans down over it, and we see what looks to all accounts to be an imperial fortress of some kind. And it's a huge monolithic structure, big iron doors, and hanging tattered, sort of blowing in the ash-filled breeze. Next to the doors are two great red ragged banners with the imperial gear on them. Standing around outside the fortress, we see a group of battle-scarred stormtroopers, their white armor burned and damaged, and a an AT-ST equally wrecked kind of like walks by, its little chicken legs moving in stop motion, and we follow it, and then we catch a glimpse up on a rocky outcropping some distance. We catch a glimpse of like light reflecting off of a glass or metal. And we wipe to a group of rebel soldiers. They're crouched down behind some rocks, and their commander, what's his name? Commander Pohar. He's a an older guy, kind of like graying hair. He's got a big bristly mustache, dark skin. He takes the macro binoculars away from his eyes and turns. And behind him, we see about a half dozen rebel troops. They seem to be gearing up for some kind of operation. So they have, blaster rifles. They're checking their weapons. One of them has a huge missile launcher that he's loading up. And among them, we see your characters. So I want to get just a visual, like what do your characters look like? Who are you with? Are you looking nervous about the upcoming operation, or are you confident? Give us an idea of where your characters are at. Do you want to start, Theron?
Sure. So
I can probably show the images as well that they made.
Yeah,
let me pull that up.
I was just about to say, like, go Google the image. That's what he looks like. but he's not. He's clearly not wearing the like standard issue rebellion gear that is in that image because he's out on a mission. So he's in, I imagine, camo related to this harsh environment, and he is a little grizzled. He has a beard, but it's a very like Star Warsian beard that doesn't have. Like has an anti-Hitler bit where like there's no mustache here, but there's beard everywhere else.
You're rocking the very popular the Crix Nadine. Yeah.
The old Crix Nadine, he's very popular in the rebellion, and I'm down.
Yeah.
And and so I am part of the whole. There's a unit within the rebellion that's like, hey, let's take down the Empire. The rebellion's so good. We're going to do all this and we're so good and everyone join us. I'm part of like that team. And it's all about publicity. And so I'm here to kind of check out the battle and stay in the background and not get too caught up in it, but actually like report what's going on to the entire galaxy and be like, the good deeds of the rebellion are doing you justice and things like that.
Nice. So are you maybe like you're talking to some of the troops, like getting them ready, like, you know, like firing them up? Because they seem a little like nervous. Or are you just observing? Are you like kind of standing apart?
Oh, no, I'm sitting there and I'm going around to all the different troops. And I'm like, look, guys, if we can destroy the Death Star, there's nothing we can't do. Right. And I'm giving everyone a pat on the back. And I was like, you know, we might not all be Luke Skywalkers, but there's a little bit Skywalker in all of us. And that kind of
awesome.
Stuff.
Yeah. So we pan across, we follow you as you're kind of like nodding to the troops and like shaking hands, like patting people on the shoulder. And you walk past a woman, maybe Sam, your character is the one that's closest to Commander Pohar. He looks to you for tactical advice. Tell us what your character looks like. Maybe the camera stops on you as Thalen goes by or Theron goes by.
Yeah, so I'm gonna link it in the chat, but the character's just like slim, athletic, long white hair. She kind of like has this like dusty robe on, but she's also got some armor on now because we're on a mission. She's holding a data pad, and basically she is an esteemed tactician. So her job is to analyze enemy patterns and the structure that these guys are looking to go into. And just like she focuses more on the tactical side than the combat itself and leaves the combat to the more capable.
Perfect. And I think that's probably a good segue. So maybe you're preparing the Lieutenant Mateen for the upcoming battle. Do you wanna tell us about your character, JP?
So Sam, what do you I wanna know what Sam's telling me to prepare for the upcoming battle.
I'm kind of just
give me some tactical advice, Sam.
I'm kind of like informing you that the troopers patrol in groups of 2 to 3, and they're time based, like just kind of stuff like that, so that you can be aware that when you see one trooper, there's going to be others, that kind of stuff.
Gotcha. So here's my character. It's Adam Mateen. I tweeted out the wrong image, but whatever. It still works. It's still a good image.
I was wondering if I tweeted out the wrong one. I was like, oops.
No, we like planned all this. We're like, all right, guys, I'm going to take noon, probably do 2 o'clock. And then I just fuck it up and tweet out the wrong image. But yeah, my character's name is Adam Mateen. He has binoculars in hands because he's kind of a scout sniper. The gun on his back is not really revealed, and I guess we'll probably... I mean, I guess I could reveal it now. I have a giant, not sand thrower. That's the wrong universe.
Slug thrower.
Slug thrower on my back, yep. Which is the weapon that the sand people use. So we'll, I guess, reveal that in due time on how I happened upon that weapon. And then my scar will also be revealed in due time in the show. But yeah, I'm kind of like the roundabout commando of the group where if something needs shooting or something needs... you know, aggressive action. That's me.
Yeah. And while the rest of the rebel troops look to Theron for inspiration, they stand a bit apart from Otto, from Lieutenant Mateen. They have a bit of like hero worship thing going on where there's a lot of like whispering and looking at him like, wow, he's like really impressive. And they whisper about like all the battles they're sure you've seen. And you're a fearsome presence. Speaking of fearsome presences, probably standing like a bit aside, looking gruff. Hillary, do you want to tell us about your character, Pocket?
I'd say my character is probably the least like talkative in this whole situation. Sort of just crouched down and focused on what they're supposed to be doing. She has like a mask pulled up over her nose, but you can still see the scar that goes across one cheek and up to almost her eye. She also has her hood on and then camouflage, of course. She's a lot more heavily geared than probably the others that we've seen so far. She has a blaster pistol in hand and then a vibro sword at her back. And she just looks like she's ready to mess stuff up. Like, she's just really ready. Oh, and she has, of course, some of her blonde hair peeking out, but most of it's tucked in to the hood, so you can't see it. So... she's just very super serious about what's going on in the mission, and she's not even really listening to Theron's pep talk. She's just sort of like tuning him out as much as she can.
Yeah, I don't think I'm listening to Theron's pep talk as well. I'm looking through my.
It's such a good one, though. Oh, guys.
I'm looking through my binoculars to try to make sure that you know. Everything's good. That we're not about to get shot from the sides because we are on a fucking weird planet, and that's just the character. He's always suspicious.
Cool. So before we start making rolls and talking about the mission ahead of you, we need to do what will become quite quickly second nature for starting the game. We need to generate our destiny pool. So this is going to be the presence of the force, either for or against you. This is the thing that I used to kill Sam's character in the last game.
just rub it in. Just let him know, Sam. Sam, did you?
After this episode, I'll let it go.
Sam, you died at the end of the last show. Did you know that?
Is when we use a destiny dice, he gets one, and because you kept using them, he killed me. You did this.
Sam, did I die?
Oh my god, the Wookiee's so good. Why does Sam suck so bad?
Did Short Shit die? No, he did not. That's right. Short Shit lives on.
That's what happened. So
no one else died, just him. So it was good for us in the end.
So to do that, everybody can go to their character sheet, and there is a little button that says Roll Destiny. It's in the Destiny pool.
We're all doing this.
So if everybody clicks Roll Destiny, you will generate some Destiny points, and that'll be our starting pool for the game.
Oh, fucking! And... what are you guys doing? Giving the
I didn't mean to.
Give me all the dark.
Fuck, yes. Man.
Let your hate flow through you.
Great. Great.
You did it too.
I know.
Everybody, yes. Wait, am I? Is that light side?
Yes. You.
You're the only one.
Wow.
So this place is strong with the dark side to be in. So I can use these points to upgrade skills that I roll against you or downgrade skills you rolled against me. It means that either skilled characters will become like more skilled, like my stormtroopers will shoot better, they'll have better morale, that kind of thing. Or I can use it to make you miss shots you'd otherwise be able to make. But the most interesting part of it, especially for y'all, is that you can use your light side points to generate circumstances for your character that's sort of like deus ex machina. Like if you need a tool that you didn't have, or if you need something to coincidentally go your way, you can use a dark side or you can use a light side point. And what'll happen is it'll give me the point and we'll just go back and forth. So you'll be able to see that on your character sheet, how many y'all have available. And when you want to use it, you can just click the point in the middle. So that'll pull those back and forth. So we have that set up. I think that Commander Pohar looks to you, Bell, and he says, "There it is, Imperial Prison Depot 424." He like looks around. He's like, "This place is hell, but that place is worse." And he kind of like looks sadly down at the ground, and he says, "It's a shame that this day and age, the Empire still clings to its slaves so desperately. We need to get in there and free those people." And he pulls the macro binoculars up to his eyes again, and we see through the binoculars, and we see the AT-ST walking by, and he says to you, he's like, "Pretty heavy armament on the outside." Looks over his shoulder nervously. "Do you think full frontal assault's going to cut it?" And he looks back at the men as they're being kind of like encouraged by Theron, and he kind of shakes his head, and he's not sure, you know. It's like you can see him being like, maybe that's a bad idea, but what do you say? Do you want to try to reassure him? Do you have a different plan?
I don't think a full front is going to work with an AT-ST.
He nods and he says, "Well, we do have some heavy armament, and you can see the team assembling the missile launcher." He says, "If we could get on that AT-ST quickly, then there's only maybe a dozen stormtroopers left over. We should be well enough to clear them out, but, well, I'm not sure. The men are frightened, and even though the intelligence says that they're not that well defended on the inside, I just don't know. You can see them struggling a little bit." And maybe Theron, you overhear this conversation. Like you've just finished kind of like telling the troops like everything's gonna go great, and then you hear the sort of negative tone that the commander is having.
I approach him from the side and put my hand on his shoulder, and ask him what he's. I'm like, what are you feeling?
Yeah, he looks up at you and he says, "Well, we have to get in there. I mean, if we don't." And he kind of like scowls. He says, we have orders from High Command to free those slaves. And, I wish we were better equipped." And he looks nervously at the AT-ST as it kind of like moves back and forth. I've got a bad feeling about this."
Can I, is there anything I can use to sort of see, or any of us can use to see? Because we're talking about a backdoor or some other strategy. Do we even know that one exists or there's another way to get in there? Because I can't say, like, we'll find a way in if there's no other way in. Yeah, right?
That's
what
they do in the movies, man. They just say, we'll figure it out, man.
Yeah, do we have any
the forces with us?
So here's the thing. This would be an opportunity for you to either analyze the current situation, right? To like look at it and make a role, like a tactics role. Or if you want to spend your destiny point, you can say, this would be where Bell could be like, well, thankfully I have blueprints for the place. And you can just have that.
No, but you we'll do, pass
I don't
want to
give you
that.
No, pass on that. Pass on that. You fucking trickster.
I'll give them back to you.
Destiny point. You guys gotta come to me first.
let's analyze the current situation.
Yeah, let's analyze it.
Yeah.
Well, okay, I just pull out my macro binoculars and take a closer look at like the ATST and.
And I'm that's what he just was listening. Doing. Yeah. I'm actually listening now because Theron's not pep talking anymore.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. And I guess. Are you gonna try to keep the other troops from listening in on like the real talk, or are you like, no, everybody can listen to this conversation? We're gonna be like, we don't really know what we're doing yet.
Well, I think we just formulate a plan as a group, and then we'll tell the plan to them.
So, I'll go back to the troops, and I'll tell them, like, guys, the commander is forming a plan. He's conversing with the rest of the team, and we are going to figure out exactly what we need to do in order to save everyone's life and get these slaves out of here alive.
Yeah, I don't want the soldiers to hear the discussion.
Okay, so the check here is going to be knowledge warfare, I think. Knowledge of strategies and tactics of warfare, both on the ground and space. No, so somebody will be the primary person making the role, and then anybody else who has warfare can help. Okay. They'll offer upgrades for the
Well, I haven't checked. Pocket, do you have it checked?
Well, I'm not going to do anything.
I have it checked. It's one of my career skills, so.
So do you have a yellow mark in it or two greens?
Yeah.
Okay, so you should be the one to make the roll and I'll help.
Yeah.
Okay, so what you're going to do on your character sheet, Tactician Bell, you already have the skill. You have fully upgraded 2 points in that, right? Or do you have just the one? Yeah, just you got two. Okay. Yeah, you got one. Okay. So what's going to happen is you're going to get an upgrade from Otto's help. So on the little dice pool, just under Destiny pool, put upgrade one. So increase upgrade to one.
Upgrade one.
Yeah, and then put two of the purple triangles, two purple dice. Okay. So that's how difficult it is. And then you can just click next to the skill, and that should just roll for you. Okay. So it's all you can see.
Sam,
from here,
could you just for once do something good?
Yeah, could you not be awful at this game, Sam?
God. The first roll and you're already a failure.
I'm coming in emotionally wounded. I want to.
You're already a failure. Also, Adam, I know this is going to get really old really quick, but if you could explain why that's a failure just for the first episode.
Yeah, yeah. For the first episode, no problem. So what we're looking at here is Belsa's warfare, knowledge warfare roll. Normally, you'd be rolling one green die and one yellow die, but because you have Otto's help, Otto upgrades one more. So you've got two of the yellow dice. Those are the best dice you can roll. The two purple dice.
Hard dice roll to fail, Sam.
It's actually quite a hard dice roll to fail.
How that happened, I have no clue.
it was
Sam.
Poor luck, yeah.
Guys, come on, man.
The purple dice reflect how difficult the roll is. Two dice is an average difficulty. And the little triangle guys mean they're bad results, and the little explosions on your dice are good. The bad and good cancel each other out, leaving you with one failure left over. So if you had rolled some disadvantage on this, I could also have said, like, it's such a bad situation that it stresses you out. You take some strain. Strain is like your mental hit points. But in this case, you just look at it, and it's, from what you can see, it's built like many Imperial fortresses. If there is another way out, you can't see it from here, and it's probably pretty well defended. Often, regional moths would build fortresses like this with, like, underground tunnels that would get them to, like, a secret escape pad. There might be a shuttle somewhere, but you can't figure it out from here. If you got another look inside, or if you got an access to the computers, you could get a way out, but getting in, you're probably going to have to go through the front door.
All right, so is it possible then to come up? Can I use, hold on, what is it? Can I use the power of, where is that ability? Hold on. The power of deception to distract an opponent through guile and get Lana to join me in sort of going off and like luring the ST away from them and having everyone else just attack the stormtroopers because stormtroopers suck. Can we pull that off?
We have a missile launcher that we're prepping to take out the AT-ST. Right now.
Yeah. So both of those. Now this weapon, It will take a couple of shots. The AT-STs are decently armored. It'll take a couple of shots, and someone will have to protect the missile launcher while that happens. But yeah, you could theoretically, with some good shots, take out the AT-ST. But also, yeah, you could definitely try a deception test if you run off and try to be like, hey, over here.
While they're going to do that, I walk over to the missile thing It's just a missile launcher. Is it like on the back? Is it one of the stationary things? What is it?
It's called like a missile tube. It's basically like a one person six shot bazooka. So a heavy weapons infantry put it up on a shoulder, probably fire it and then move and fire it again. It can fire six times before it's out. So this guy has two other guys. There's a technician and a guard that'll be kind of protecting him. Okay. while he fires on the ATST.
Okay, so what if we split up into three groups? So we have missile group one. We have another group that is we're going to start shooting at the stormtroopers when the ATST turns to the missiles, which we know it will. We shoot at the stormtroopers. A few are going to come after us, then everyone else come from a different direction and hit the remaining stormtroopers at the front. So like the vast majority of us are that third group. And so we have, like, for example,
so you want the missiles, then you want a diversion group, and then you want like the core group to come in.
Yeah, so we can split we can split them all up. Yeah, and then the core group comes in. So I would imagine, for example, like maybe Elsa and Mateen could be one group, and they could be the distraction group, and then
I was gonna shoot the rocket.
Oh, you're gonna shoot the rocket? Okay. Yeah. Well then let's have Elsa be in the main group. And then Lana and I can go do our, like, we can go off to the side and attack, like, try to lure as many stormtroopers away as possible. Because then I'll use my, like, deception and be like, oh, no, here they come. And we'll just run away and lure them away as fast as we can. Is that a plan?
That works.
That seemed like a plan.
Yeah, I do you say that, like, in character, basically? Eloquently, so, maybe?
Yeah, so I turn away from the soldiers, and I look back at the commander, and I'm like, I've just had an idea, commander. What if we stage a three-pronged assault? We'll call it Operation Pitchfork. And we have Mateen, who will man the missile launcher, and Lana and I will form a secondary unit that will try to lure as many stormtroopers away from the entrance as possible, while you and Belsa... Ugh, I hate your name. You and the Frost Queen go off and lead the main forces in a frontal assault on the remaining troops at the door.
So you say that, and one of the soldiers, I think probably the technician for the missile launcher, looks at Mateen and says, what do you mean give the missile launcher to him? We've been training for this mission. How do I even know he's going to be able to shoot that thing straight?
Is he an older or younger kid?
Most of them are younger, yeah.
Okay. I just kind of look at him and just say, kid, how many of those have you fired? And then I just, put my hand on the weapon and start, like, slowly taking it from him, as I'm saying.
Yeah. He shakes his head. He's like, I've been in 16 combat missions. Simulated.
Kid, back on Hoth, I fired five or six of those, and every single one of them hit.
And stand up and turn around for once, like not focused on the front anymore. And I sort of walk up to the kid that Otto's talking to, and I put my hand on his shoulder and I say, kid, let it go. And then I push him back in the direction that I just came from. And then take my place next to Theron.
Okay. Yeah. So I think that between the two of you, you just like take the rocket launcher away from him, and I think that they're like distracted both by your kind of intimidating presence, and then when you say like, man, back on Hoth, one of the other guys is like, see, I told you he was at Hoth, and the other guy, and then they start like talking. He's like, I thought he was at Endor, and they like start like debating that as you just like walk away with the launcher. So Otto, it's not in great shape. The launcher itself, like, it looks like it's been used. It's probably, you know, as old as any of these characters are. But it should still work. It should be able to fire missiles at the thing. You've got six shots. But it's going to be it's going to be that first shot that counts. Now, thankfully, this weapon is guided. They're guided missiles. So if you take the time to lock on, even if you miss, it has another chance to swing around and hit the thing. But once you start firing, you're going to be target number one, and it's going to bring all its guns to bear.
Can I do the three round of aiming or two rounds of aiming to prep the shot?
Well, yeah, because we need to sneak around to the opposite side of the facility in order to lure some guys away. So while we do that, you can prep.
Okay, that works. Yeah, so I just grab it, I immediately just start aiming.
you're still outside. I think you bring the launcher to your eye and get the overlay, and you can see it trying to get a target, but you're still out of range. You'll have to creep up closer. You guys have to get down the slope of the hill a little bit closer before you can get into range of the gun.
Yep, I grab you said there was a technician and a guy guarding me, and then the guy that had the gun.
Yeah, and then there's about, like, you know, 8 or 9 other kind of miscellaneous.
Okay. I just turn around. I'm just like, you guys come with me. We're going to get closer so I can fire off this rocket.
Okay.
All right. So I'm leading the distraction party then?
No, you're leading. You're with the main force. You're with the commander.
Yeah, you're leading the core.
Okay. Do you want to give everybody a little speech before? Do you want to do some speechifying before you go into battle, Theron?
Me?
Yeah, I mean, you can make a roll, right? Lord. Like, you have a leadership, you have a skill for
the commander's still shaken, so...
I guess that's true.
maybe like, Theron starts to speak, and Otto just rolls his eyes and starts to speak.
And you see...
Just walks away.
And yeah. You see Lena just sort of, like, her eyes just glaze over. Like, she's heard this.
Yeah. So, like, we're wondering... I look over at Lena and just, like, do you think he's going to go with that one? Like, we've heard him right. All before.
And I'm like, no, I think he's going to go with the other one. You know the other one that he usually does. I think he's going to go with that one.
Yeah.
And so we, like, start silently taking bets.
Yeah. From the snowy fields of Hoth to the forest jungles of Endor, let it be known this day. Of course, this is like speech... 14B.
Yeah, and this is when Theron's theme starts to play. We get some, like, military drums and, like, some trumpets start to play.
And I look at Otto and I'm like, oh, you were right. Dang it. And I, like, sort of just pass him some credits. Like,
awesome.
Right. And the speech is roughly about how it's not about us, but it's about the rebellion, about the new republic and the slaves inside this facility. That once we set them free, that we're changing the face of the galaxy, one sentient species, one whatever at a time, and
one
soul
at a time.
Yeah, this is it's beyond us. It's more important than us. And if you die here this day, your name will echo through the halls of the Jedi Temple on Yavin forever. That kind of stuff.
Awesome. Okay, so we're gonna make a leadership test. I will give you an advantage die. We'll give you a boost die for that stirring speech. So in your dice pool, just add one of the blue dice, and two of the purple dice is just a standard difficulty.
Okay. And what am I rolling?
And then you can scroll on down to find leadership.
Oh, leadership.
Leadership in this case. Yeah.
Okay. Wow. All right. Yeah.
And then
roll leadership. Roll. Leadership.
Yep. Oh.
That's good, right?
I think it's
success and advantage.
Yeah, it's really good.
That's great. That's what you want. Yeah, you didn't get any negatives. You got a success on your boost die. So if you hadn't role played that as good, you would have failed this roll. So on this roll, yeah, your characters will get a boost against fear. That's what leadership does. It insulates the characters against fear effects. So later, when they're getting shot at by an AT-ST, they're going to remember this speech and they're going to keep fighting. And if you had any strain, you could use that advantage to reduce it. But you can also, if you want, you can use that advantage to give a boost die to the next person who acts. So who do you want to give that advantage die to? It can be for Otto to fire.
Yeah, no, it's for Otto. It's for Otto completely, because he's the linchpin of this entire operation. If he misses, we're screwed. So yes, definitely to him.
Okay. All right. So, Otto, I don't know. How does the advantage come to you? Like, obviously you're not that swayed by Theron's speech.
Well, maybe,
but
maybe
it helps
his,
you in some way.
Yeah. Maybe his speech, like Otto's in there, I guess he's already starting to sneak forward and like crawling on his belly through whatever to try to get as close as possible. And, he's heard the same speech before, but it was back on a successful mission. So like, I think back to that mission where we were successful, regardless of the speech. But it was maybe just because, like, I did something similar where I sat on a hill and tried to take a shot over a long amount of time and hit the shot. So it's not that his speech rouses me. It's more that it brings back memories of me doing successful.
That's awesome. Yeah, yeah, yeah. The familiar like weight of the weapon in your hands, and the worn like leather of its handle, and the sound of the speech, and then this place too. Like you're in an obvious conflict zone. It's just hot, and there's like ash blowing in the air. And the two of you, it's your unit, but it's actually the whole group, right? Like that's moving down into position. Or Belle, are you leading a different group elsewhere?
Core that's going to be like, I was under the impression that Theron and I were going to be together doing a distraction run. Perfect. And then, okay.
Yeah. So there's, so if you imagine it again, it's like the pitchfork, there's one group here and then like we're going to be over here. And then the main force is over here. And so when he fires the rocket, the ATST is going to come for them. We're going to lure a few guys away this way, and then the rest of the group's going to come this way.
Yeah, to pretty much get some weight off of them.
So what's the signal to attack? Because you know, I mean, all of you, Belle especially, like these guys have blaster rifles, which are at a much closer range than the extreme range of the missile launcher. So they're going to need to get closer if you want to attack all at once. Or the missile will fire first, and then they'll kind of like rush you. So it's up to you where you want to place everybody.
Wouldn't it be like we just wait? Like the signal would be we wait for the missile to fire, which is going to take what, like 3 turns?
Yeah, I mean, we have to wait, and then
like 2 or 3 turns.
I feel like you and I should get as close as possible, and then we wait for him to fire. He fires, and then we start getting off a few pop shots and lure them to us, and then we just hightail it out of there. Meanwhile, the main group goes in and launches the real assault.
Okay. Well, let me get everybody's character on the range map, and we can place where you intend to go. I'm going to need to get like stealth checks if you want to approach stealthily to make sure that the Empire doesn't notice you before you get in range. Okay. Especially the missile team there. So let me just get you all on here. So I'm going to leave you on the left side of the map for now, just outside extreme range. And remember, too, you can fire at extreme range, Otto, but the closer you get to the target, the easier it's going to be to hit.
Okay,
so there's the AT-ST and the Stormtroopers. And they're kind of the middle of our map. And then y'all are out at the edge here, and then I'll add an Alliance team, so Rebel team. Okay, there you are. So where there's cover strewn kind of throughout the area, you can hide behind huge blocks of like basalt or like hillocks of volcanic stone. There's lots of places to kind of hide out. So sneaking up should be easier than usual. But I want to know basically how far do you want to go, Otto, before you get ready to take your shot?
How close can I get without being super like fucked?
It's an inverse thing in proportion, right? The closer you get, the more likely the stormtroopers are going to be like, hey, there's somebody out there, go check it out. But the easier the shot will be when you take it. And you can see, we can basically treat the difficulty the same as the range. So the little gray triangles in there, that's how many negative dice you're going to have to roll when you make the shot. The closer you get, the better. But it's also going to be the same difficulty for them to notice you.
Can we, like, distract some of the troopers without them calling in the ATST on us, or should we just wait for the missile?
We should wait, because what's going to happen is, at least in my mind, the missile fires, they see it hit the ATST, hopefully, and then everyone's like, "What the?" And they all start looking that way, and that's when you and I hit them from the side, and then they're sort of frazzled, and so when we run, hopefully some of them will follow us, and that's when the main group comes and hits them from the other side that they're not even facing. And hopefully they'll all be killed instantly. Like, that's the hope.
Okay.
Yeah, totally. So just to get you like mechanically on the same page. So for blaster rifles, their maximum range is long. So for the stormtroopers to be able to engage the rebel team, this is the range band they need to be in. Any closer and it'll be easier, but anything out that, you can't. And then extreme range is how far your missile launcher can go. Now, Belsa, you've studied Imperial tactics and Imperial technology. If you want to make a knowledge warfare role, I can tell you a bit about the AT-ST's weapons and kind of what they have available. Okay, so an AT-ST is pretty straightforward. I think probably just two difficulty dice on your roll. Okay. So just make sure you have the two triangles there, and then go ahead and click your knowledge warfare. Yeah, much better. Okay. So let's talk real quick about the AT-ST, the All-Terrain Scout Transport. So there's going to be two people on board, two trained members of the Imperial military. One's going to be the gunner, one's going to be the pilot. The AT-STs are quite quick, and they're able to traverse difficult terrain. And their armaments include a port-mounted light blaster, a starboard-mounted concussion grenade launcher, and then two heavy blaster cannons under the chin. And for range, it's going to be probably on par with the missile launcher. So it's got a pretty good range. It's meant for taking out both infantry with the concussion grenade launcher and then other vehicles.
Okay. So are our groups split already, or have we yet to split?
I think this is like you're just about to be like, okay, go.
Okay, so I go over to Otto and I'm kind of briefing him, and I'm like, Otto, you're going to need to move location every time you shoot. These guys are really good at taking out infantry.
I kind of stare at him with just like really dumb eyes, like, yeah, yep, got that.
Okay, good.
Thank you.
I just return to the main group.
As we start to split, I walk behind Otto and pat him on the back, and I say, "If Ewoks can do it, you certainly can." And walk away.
I just like give you like the rudest look, but like.
And I just sort of chuckle behind him as I'm walking behind Theron, just chuckling.
Yeah, it's a rude look, but it's totally like only it's covert enough that only you guys would notice it. Like, you can feel me staring at you and looking through your fucking soul, Theron, as you're walking away.
Listen, it's classic. All you need to do is just get two logs and just smash them in the side. It's fine. Missile launcher, it's going to be easy.
Yeah. So I turn around. I'm just like, all right, any questions? To look at all the people coming with me, Adam.
Yeah, I think that they shake their head. They're just watching you for orders.
Okay. It's like, we're going to move after each shot. Make sure you stick with me. If you go down, we'll make sure that, we get you out of here. Then I just turn and roll my eyes and start going.
Grizzled old soldier. Well, what are you going to do? Okay. Yeah. Cool. All right. So, you can make a roll if you want to try and sneak up. There's going to be separate roles here.
Can I do stealth for that?
Each group. Yeah. So it's going to be stealth. Okay. So
what do I put in my dice pool?
Yeah, let's do the split here. So you're going with is it pronounced Lana? How does your character's name pronounced? Lana Jory.
Lana doesn't matter. So.
Okay. All right. Lana and Otto, you're going with. Just you and the
no,
two.
No, I'm going with Theron.
Yeah. Oh, you're going with Theron now. Okay.
Theron and I are going to be distraction party. Otto's going with a couple of grunts.
Got it. So. Okay, so basically everybody else is the other team.
Yeah, I'm by myself.
Mm-hmm. Perfect. Got it now. Okay, cool.
Yeah, it's all me and the grunts.
So Otto, then this will just be you making a stealth stealth check.
And then what goes in the dice pool for you?
So the difficulty on this is going to be two plus give yourself a boost die.
Two purple?
Two purple and give yourself a boost die. The boost die is because the terrain is so rocky and because it's quite dark, you'll have an advantage. Okay.
So then
I'll roll for the stormtroopers to see if they notice.
So I put that into the dice pool.
He also has my boost. Yeah. He has the thing that I gave him too. The advantage.
Oh yeah. I have the advantage.
Yes.
So
yes. Yeah, so make sure two.
Okay, so I put all that in the dice pool, and then I click stealth.
And then that'll that'll be my difficulty for rolling.
Do this.
All right, here's the roll.
Come on.
I think I did. Oh
my god.
I think I did really bad.
Yeah. Nope. So you gain advantage, but the distraction I think happens. The distraction happens sooner than you expect. They're definitely distracted, but it's because they see you right away. And we get a tight cut to them as one of the stormtroopers like pats another one on the shoulder and points, and we see you like run between two rocks, and then he looks up and touches his helmet and points over there, and the walker kind of like turns its body and starts to like walk up the hill.
I guess as that happens, I'm like looking through the sights and I'm just like, ah, shit. I start to prep for the shot and then start to move. Like, I try to buy as much time as possible for the other group.
Do we see this? Does the distraction party see this?
Yeah, definitely. So I think that the commander, as you're getting like ready to go, the commander sees this happen and looks over to you, to the tactician, and he's like, things are about to get a little more complicated. And
I jump on the comms to Lena and Tharn, and I'm like, change of plans. Otto's in trouble.
Okay. Thankfully, Otto's, because you failed, Otto, you get spotted, but because it's so like clear and obvious, those four advantage, you can spend them to make it harder for them to hit you, and you can spend them to give bonus actions to the other team. So basically you're just like, yep, okay, they see me, and you're going to be as distracting as possible so that those advantage get passed over to the other side.
A quick question. If I put two boost die in there, is it make sense for only one to show up?
Or did you cancel it out somehow? No, you should have an extra one. Do you wanna roll one more?
You can
roll just the die by in the dice pool, just setting everything to zero, clicking the little refresh, and then you can just click one and then click the d20 in the middle.
Metagame begins.
Well, that's the same fucking result.
it didn't help anyway.
The worst fucking game. Sam fucking passed on his roll STDs.
Yeah, I'm glad it's you, not me.
Listen, all I'm saying is if you want to make these rolls easier on yourselves, you just got to spend that destiny point.
I was going to save the destiny point for the shot.
Nope. Yeah, no.
That's a really good call.
As I hear the comms, I sort of just look over to Tharn, just waiting for him to tell me what to do. Like, as we're walking along.
I mean, let's roll initiative. Let's make that happen. So for initiative, if you click your token and then on your character sheet, under combat, there's a checkbox for show initiative.
Under combat, yeah.
Under combat, there you can see show initiative. Just click your token, make sure that's checked. And this is cool for initiative because you are prepared for the fight, so you're gonna be rolling your cool as opposed to your vigilance. And you can just go ahead and click it without any additional modifiers. Just make sure your pool is clear.
Under combat.
Yeah. See. Yeah, Tharn, you got it there.
Where's combat?
Jesus,
it's the third red tab.
Mine just says group sheet.
No, look below.
No,
that.
Further down. Yeah, keep going.
In your dice pool, under the dice pool, it says combat in red text.
Ah, got it.
So let me just roll for these dudes.
No, that's not right at all, Sam.
No, that's not the right thing. Show initiative. There we go.
Bell just shoots someone randomly.
He just starts shooting.
Are we rolling vigilance?
Cool. You're rolling cool. Yeah, because you were prepared for the prepared for the battle. So I'll roll twice. Stormtroopers and stormtroopers. There we go. So this looks a little different maybe than the initiative orders we're used to because there are two numbers. The way initiative shakes out is it's how many successes did you get? And then to help you break ties, it's how many advantage did you get on your roll? And it's not individual. It's not individual initiative. It's group initiative. So we create slots. So it's going to be four PCs in any order, and then two NPCs in any order, and then four PCs. And we just go back and forth like that. So it could be, you could put your characters in any order, and then next time change that order in case you want somebody else to go first.
Gotcha. Okay, so I get it.
Yeah, so any person can go right now.
Well, I want to fire rockets last this round.
I'd say that Tharn should make a judgment call, and then I'll follow his order.
Yeah, so I realize that our comrade is in serious trouble, so I pull out my blaster, and at the top of my lungs, jump out from behind a thing, and shout for the rebellion, and
I once again roll my eyes, and I'm just like, that's gonna give us away.
I fire at the closest stormtrooper. I assume I won't hit him, but I'm trying to. I guess the distance is too far, but we're a distraction, so it doesn't really particularly matter to me.
Okay.
And we're like away further, aren't we?
Yeah, we're a little further back.
Mm-hmm. No, I mean from Elsa or Melsa, whatever.
Yeah, we should be on the other side, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, you can. I mean, Belsa, put yourself wherever you were, just in general, like compared to the other members of the group.
I would say that we would be on this side and they would be on the other side because they're a distraction with I.
Like over here.
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
I mean, I assumed you were approaching from this angle, but if you want to split up and come at it, it's basically got a wall behind it, so you can't approach from like assume that the wall's like that. And so this is sort of the entrance.
Yeah, we just wanted to hit the other side, and then he would be on the opposite of us and come in. Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Good stuff. All right.
What do I need to do?
Okay, so if you want to go first, and then who's the like grunts with? They're the grunts and the commander. They're with you, tactician.
They're with Sam.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Perfect. All right. So we'll just have them act to support you. They won't go on their own initiative. They'll just go on initiative with you. Okay. So first person in the order is going to be Thalen. What are you doing? Are you just moving? On a combat round, you can perform a maneuver, which is like moving or aiming. Making an action that isn't like attacking, and then you can also make a more intense action, like firing a weapon. Or you can make two maneuvers, and a maneuver allows you to move one range band. So you're at extreme range with the stormtroopers and the ATST now.
All right, so I want to move under cover of the rocks because I want to stand up, shout. I'm gonna say for the New Republic because it's that time period. I'm gonna say for the Republic, and I just start. I move into long range under cover of the rocks and start shooting at the stormtroopers.
Okay, sure. So you move to cover and then you wanna take a shot. Now what weapon do you have?
A medium range blaster pistol.
Okay, so you can fire at them, but all it's gonna do is be for show, right? It's like
Right. I'm trying to more than hit them, try to get them to come after me.
Okay. So let me just double check what a maneuver allows you here. Yeah, one range band closer or further away from your enemy. So that's cool. So you move one range closer. And then I think in this case, you're using one of your skills to to deceive them, basically just like firing at them to get their attention, right?
Yeah.
So let's have you roll.
Deception?
Yeah, maybe. I think
distract
so.
Distract an
that,
opponent
that
through
sense.
Guile. Is that what that is?
Definitely. Yeah.
All right.
They're gonna summon Guile from Street Fighter V and distract him.
Oh, it's over. It's over. Then I give up.
Sonic.
Okay. And so the deception difficulty here is gonna be, let's see what their vigilance is, and we'll stand those opposed to each other. Okay. So difficulty is three purple dice, and I'm gonna go ahead and use a destiny point to upgrade that. We're gonna give them a little bit of extra juice.
What is that?
Okay,
another
so
purple?
What? Yeah, no. So it turns one of those purple into a red.
Oh. Ain't that about a bag of weens? Okay.
And I will use one of my points. And there you go. Now you have two.
Oh my God! All right, deception. Let's do this thing. Believe in yourself, me.
Yeah,
oh,
you did it.
Yeah!
Nice work.
Dude,
nice
that's a really good
result
roll.
Too.
Also, Adam, if you want to explain that. Just so people understand.
Yeah,
first
yeah, yeah, sure. So this result, the reason why the result is just one success is because you have three successes and two of the failure markers. And then the disadvantage and the advantage, those little wings and the little hexagon thing, those all cancel each other out, leaving you with one success, which means that at least for the immediate moment, those stormtroopers, they're not going to support the ATSD. They turn and they're like, oh, there's more coming from this way. Let's go. And they like grab their weapons and they're going to start hustling into range to get shots at you. And I'm going to put a little marker on you so that we know you're behind cover. So you're approaching, but you've got some defense there. And put a little castle on you. There you go. Cool. Okay. So that's the first PC. Who's the next slot that's going to go?
I guess I'll go since I'm following his lead.
Yeah.
And, and I see that he's already taken a shot and that he's actually successfully distracted them. And so I want to roll into cover, but not like right next. I'm going to move one in and then roll into cover, but not reveal that I'm there just yet.
Okay, so you want to stay hidden?
Yeah, I want to stay hidden. And that way, if they come up, then I can turn around and pull out my sword.
Okay, that sounds good.
Because they know he's there, but they don't know I'm there yet, hopefully. So do I have to roll?
So yeah, so in this case, you're gonna roll your you're gonna roll your stealth. Okay. You can maneuver and you can make a stealth roll to stay hidden. Okay. Now, if Theron had gotten some advantage on his deception roll, this would be a thing that would help you to hide better, right? Because they'd be really distracted by him. But instead of being specifically distracted by Theron, they're like, oh, there's just some rebels coming to get us. So they're gonna just look in that direction. So it actually doesn't help you. But that's okay. You can still make your stealth roll.
Do I have to change any of the dice at all, or?
Yeah. So add. You want to add two in your dice pool. Add two purple dice.
Okay.
I'm gonna say add one boost die for the terrain. But which also add. That's blue the one. Blue one. Yeah. Okay. Add one blue one and also add one black one because they're alerted to your presence. They're looking in your general direction.
Okay.
Yeah. And then you should be able to just roll stealth. hold on. So this before this happens, if you'd like, Otto, you can throw around some of those helping
dice. You got four.
You got like four. So if you want to help hide, you can just be loud and obnoxious, and that'll help.
I'd say save them. If they see me, then they see me. They know we're already here. So yeah. I just more so wanted to get a surprise on them. I'd say save them for someone who actually is going to need them.
Okay. Yeah, you can save them for shots.
Yep.
Oh, ooh, okay.
Oh gosh.
So you're definitely exposed.
Well, now they want me instead.
But you're exposed with an advantage. So hold on.
Yeah.
Adam's going to help you somewhat.
Exactly. You're exposed with an advantage, so you fail at the thing you were trying to do, which is hide. So they see you.
I think you're 3 feet in front of them, just like hiding on the ground, and they just have their guns pointed at you.
Well, they're still running your way, so that happens. But yeah, you can pass that advantage along to someone else to further help them. So what happens in this system is it's meant to sort of roll from one action to the other as you're passing each other helping dice, and then also once you start taking. Once you start taking strain, it'll help you reduce that. So the rule for, and these are in the player handouts if you ever want to take a look, there's a combat reference sheet. You can see on the combat reference sheet all your maneuvers you can take. You can see what all the results are for your rolls. So for one advantage, you can recover a strain. You can add one to the next allied active character's check. You can notice something important, such as a control panel or weak point. And you can activate crits or weapon qualities when you're making shots. So definitely come back to that handout on the regular till we get used to it, because it'll give you extra information that you can use. So your choice with that advantage is, do you want to pass it along to the next person, or do you want to use it and I'll tell you something that might be useful to you?
I say we should pass it to... I mean, we should give all the advantage possible to...
Otto.
Oh, yeah,
no,
Otto.
It has to go to the next person making a maneuver.
I'm making a maneuver.
It'll go to me.
Well, I think
it'll go to whoever takes the next one, so it might be...
Well, I'm supposed to shoot next, so...
Yeah, I think Otto should shoot next, because you guys shouldn't move in, Sam, until that AT-ST is taken care of.
Well, the thing is, we're at extreme range, so I need to expend turns to move in. Like, we can't ambush unless we're medium to short, at least.
Yeah, you gotta hustle.
I have to move this whole group in.
The thing is, though, is I have an ATST fucking walking straight towards me, and it gets to shoot next round.
You shouldn't have got caught, should you, mate?
Well, I think.
Yeah, pass the advantage to JP and let JP go next.
Yeah, I was gonna say if Otto goes next, I pass my advantage to him.
All right, so Otto, time to engage Otto fire. You want to shoot at the ATST?
Yep.
Okay, so you are at long range for the ATST. It is a silhouette. I think it's got one more. So do you want to move first, or do you want to stay where you are and aim?
Am I still in extreme range? I didn't get to long.
No, no, you're at long now, right? Because you're two range bands away from it.
Yeah.
You don't move yourself though. You count the number of bands between you and it.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
Right, so it's at short range from the engagement point, but it's still.
Oh, it's still in long range for me. Okay.
Yeah.
No, so, I don't.
Yeah, so your option here is to aim or to move forward. Let me take a quick look at the weapon. It's on the Rebel Trooper sheet because it's got some conditions. Okay.
Why don't we cliffhanger this and take a break? Because we're a little bit over.
Sure. Okay. Yeah. So the last thing we see before the break is you like get the rocket launcher up on your shoulder, and we see the AT-ST stomping forward through the sights. Cool.
Oh, no.
Cool.
I was waiting to see. Jesse was like saving his breath for a word there, and I was like, it's going to be a good one. And then he just says, oh, no. He just says, oh, no. So that's great.
Yeah,
that's
fantastic.
That's fantastic. All right, let's take our first break here on Bounce Power. We'll come back and go into hour two right after this. Don't go anywhere. We'll see you guys then.